New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carrol. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. You to New Arts Alive, and with me as my guest is Merrill Wagner. And Merrill is a painter in the general term. The materials might make you think a little different because of stones that you work with or metal, but in the element is about paint, color, and paint, isn't it? Would that be a good quick two words or something?
Right.
And I think I would like for you, Merrill, to sort of, because you had been in, it was about, what, 3 years ago or four? On the TV program?
Yeah, I think it was five even.
Five?
Yes.
What we're doing basically tonight is talking about her work since your first TV program.
Right.
And what we're doing is we're formulating a dialogue, conversation with Merrill, because in the fall she will be having an exhibition at the New Arts Program. And as I do with now with all of the people that I have in for exhibitions is that I have them in for the TV program and have them transcribed, and that makes a booklet for each of them so that the public, when they come in, they can not only look at it, but they can also get some thinking about the person, how they think about or speak about some of the things that they are involved with. And what I would like is for you to sort of, at the beginning, in a kind of a synopsis way, talk about your work and generally from then in sort of a quick, don't do it for a couple minutes about it if you can.
Just talk about the work.
The work since about 4 or 5 years ago to the present. What is your source, your dreams about that kind of undertaking?
Well, the slides that I brought are from 2005, so they're really very recent.
There's one 04 too.
Well, no, that was 02. That was 2002, but that's a different one, and we'll
cover that.
I do work in different ways at different times. And many of the different kinds of work, most of the work that I do, be it drawing or painting or on stone or on steel, often has a source in thoughts about the landscape. And the slides that I brought to show tonight are all very recent, 2005, but they're not landscapes. I mean, they're not, there's no horizon line. They're abstract paintings, except for the one that was in 2002, and that is
sort of a little jewel at
it's
the
a
end.
Little, no, it's just a little landscape.
Yeah.
And the, and it's yellow, it's a yellow painting. It's actually, it's forsythia. And I paint the forsythia, I do paintings from the landscape with an easel and,
Outside.
And looking at a subject.
As you paint.
Yeah, as I paint. And I paint whenever remarkable things appear in the landscape, like the forsythia. We have a place in near Bloomsburg, Pennsylvania, and there's about an acre, it's almost an acre of just forsythia that's gone wild. And there's just this bright...
Berserk.
It's berserk, and it's like this thing
yellow
behind
of
us.
The
yeah.
felt here.
Yeah, and I paint that every year when it comes out. I paint it. I also paint, the snow is interesting to paint too when there's snow, and and other, you know, and the leaves in the autumn, and flowers in the summer, and stuff like that. But the forsythia is really a big mark, like, because it's kind of the end of winter, or, you know, and we're going forward into another time period. And so I put that in because the earlier paintings in the slide selection that we're going to see are yellow paintings. And I didn't start yellow paintings until very recently, well, since 2002. And they really have, the yellow paintings have an origin in the work that I did from the forsythia. I mean, the little paintings that I made from the forsythia with the, because they're bright. The forsythia is, you know, straight out of the tube, cadmium yellow light, different. Actually, that brings up another point that cadmium yellow light in certain kinds of paint is much darker than cadmium yellow light in other kinds of paint. So I have two tubes of cadmium yellow light, and one, and they're of different brands. And I, you know, sometimes the
that's very common within brands to
right. But the blooms, when the blooms are lighter, I'll use
earlier in the spring.
Old Holland. No. In the same patch of forsythia, some of the blooms, you know, will be. It might be the light of the sun on them. Some will be lighter, appear lighter than others, and so I'll use either, I think Block is a very, is a darker yellow cadmium yellow light than Old Holland, and so I'll use one for.
One's richer than the other.
Yeah. And right now I don't remember which is which, but, and also Winsor Newton. They're all different. I mean, all the cadmium yellow that you can buy, they're all different from one another. So it's very confusing when you go to buy paint. And so the abstract paintings that we'll see in this selection are, you'll see that there are different yellows. There are strips of different yellows. And each of the different yellows in one painting are a different kind of rust preventive paint on steel. So
they come out of a spray can, or is it come out of a regular can
can.
It's a paste in a liquid?
Yeah,
it's just the viscosity is like any house paint type.
Yeah, and that's what I used to paint on steel because that's the thing that works the best.
Well, it clings pretty good too.
Yeah,
doesn't it?
It what?
Clings.
Yes.
It holds. It binds.
Yeah, right. Because it's meant to be used on
metal.
On metal. And so some of the paintings that you see will be different brands of rust preventive paint. And I started getting interested in yellow maybe because of the forsythia, but also I went to Wyoming to the UCross Foundation in 2002, and there's a lot of Naples yellow in the landscape, which is really interesting. And so I did a lot of Naples yellow paintings.
That's out by Cody, isn't it? Wyoming, or is
it's,
Cody close to
it's
it?
Not, it's not, let's see, it's near...
What town is
it? Well, let's see.
I'm trying to think of some of the
Buffalo,
other...
Buffalo, it's near Buffalo, and...
Well, that must be a little town.
Yeah, they're... Well, they're
most of them aren't very large.
Most of them are very little.
Most of the bigger towns are down by Cheyenne and Laramie and Green River and Rawlins, and which are down in the very southern along what used to be Highway 30. I don't know what highway it is anymore. But this is up...
I think it's further north, yeah.
It is.
I forget where it is that you fly to get there. I mean, you fly to Denver and then you take a little tiny plane to...
Frontier, probably.
Yeah, that's right, Frontier Airlines to... I forget the name of it.
I can't even come up with any names up in that part. That's all right. It's just a thought.
Well, anyway, so I began making these yellow paintings slowly, first on canvas and then on steel.
Then you ventured into the metal. Is that a normal occurrence in some ways?
What?
To do your paintings on canvas and then sort of
no.
changes happen in that way?
Oh, well, I don't.
Do they first happen with your canvas work?
No, I don't. I'm
just curious.
Yeah. Well, the canvas work is usually, let's see. The canvas work is either the little paintings from nature.
Yeah.
Or I work on canvas, abstract, larger paintings. I'm usually working on one or another, but they take a long time, and I only do one or two a year, maybe, or just a handful a year. So they're not very many, and I do many, many more paintings on steel.
Metal.
Yeah, on metal. It's usually always steel. And then I also brought some, I usually also work on stone somewhat, but I've been doing a different thing recently. On stone, I've been finding stones in our stream, the stream that goes through our property, and finding ones that I thought would be good to paint on. And so I bring them out of the stream. And recently I've been drawing on them with oil pastel, but I think they're very interesting looking the way they are, so I don't want to cover up much of them. So that I just made lines on them that are very spare, and those are in this batch too.
So on your canvases you use oil paints.
Mm-hmm.
On metal you use industrial paints,
yeah,
which usually are rusted.
Well, they're always rust paints.
On stone you use have used up to this point oil stick.
I have used oil paint too, but on this particular batch that I'm going to show you, this it's only drawing with oil pastel.
Okay. Okay, if we can see the first slide that we have, and this is called Float, correct?
Yeah.
I mean, that's what we're going to be seeing in a
yes.
moment. And from your information here, it's 96 by 28. So 28 inches. It's a vertical piece.
Right. It's a very tall piece. Do we see it?
Okay, what we're doing. And we have it here.
Yeah. Well, let's see. That's, is there a way to adjust it? Because we don't see the top and bottom.
There we are.
There we do. Okay, so
each one of these different colors, mm-hmm, and the way you've applied the paint on them, they're different pieces, size of pieces, are they not?
Yeah, each color is a different
of
piece.
Yellow.
Each color of yellow is a different piece. And then one on the far right,
it's coming through as almost a brown or a black.
Well, that's unpainted.
Oh, that's the steel. Steel,
yeah,
itself. What about that little square up in the top?
Oh, there's a little blue mark that I get these pieces from the steel place that makes steel near me in Benton, Pennsylvania.
They use them from the sheet metal places?
Yeah, it's a sheet metal
place. So you use scraps?
Yeah, they're all scraps. And that, actually this is 1, 2, 3, 4 strips of hot rolled steel, 16 gauge. And that little square up there is a sort of a pale blue mark that somebody put on it, I guess to show that it was sold to somebody special, or I don't know. It was a mark that is often, it's often on the steel when I get it. There's a little blue mark like that.
Oh.
And so I thought I would just let it show in this painting.
Okay, now you apply the paint with a brush. So
yeah. I didn't make the blue
okay.
mark.
It just
yeah,
just
blue
natural.
Mark was there and I left it unpainted.
It came that way, and so you don't bother it.
Right.
If they don't come that way, you might bother.
Yeah, right.
But the when we were in close there, we can see the way in which the application of the paint becomes a very crucial element for you. Does it not?
No. I mean, I just paint the way I was going to paint, and then I thought I liked the way it looked.
But it so is different. It. You know, each one becomes different.
Yeah. It's only painted one coat. Each one of these are one pass, they say, as you say, each of the strips. And they're each strip, I think the strokes maybe look different. And that's partly because of the viscosity of the paint or the translucency.
It's also the application of the amount of loading the brush and the putting it on.
But I didn't make a conscious difference in the way I applied the paint.
Just whatever happened.
Yeah. And, of course, I used a different brush for each. And there was...
Each piece?
Yeah, for each different color on each different piece, I used a different brush. But I didn't...
Do you work on more than one composite piece at a time, or do you work on a number of them?
Mostly
one at a time.
One,
pretty much. Composing one at a time.
Yeah, pretty much.
It's sort of like composing, in a way. You're putting...
Sometimes I might work on more than one, but
usually
a lot of the time it's one, I guess. I might work on... go out and paint the forsythia in the morning of one day, and then that night I might paint on the steel painting. And then I might the next day draw on some stone. I mean, and that's working on more than one at a time.
Okay, we'll go to the next work that you have. And this one is called Another Spring Painting.
Yeah.
And it is also dated this year.
Yeah, and I guess it would have to be in the spring. You know, it was in the spring, like April maybe.
Okay, and it's 18 inches high, and it's about 44 inches wide. These are on the wall.
Yeah. Oh, they're attached by magnets. Everybody thinks that's
kind of important because I had a person who used metal, but he used tape to.
Oh, really?
Yes.
What kind of tape?
Industrial tape. I mean.
Like gaffer's tape or duct tape?
Well, it's. It was double adhesive tape.
Oh, okay.
And particularly for permanent pieces. Mm-hmm. But this way, using magnets, you don't have any residue.
No.
Once you take it off.
You have a hole, though, because you have to screw the hole in.
Well, you know, you can plug those like nails.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah,
I mean, that's much easier than actually sometimes correcting tape that's being pulled off.
Yeah, maybe. Well, I don't know.
Who knows?
Everything has its problems.
Yes. And so we can see on the left, we can see where there's a strip coming down, which is raw.
Yeah.
And then we can see on the extreme left, that's painted.
Mm-hmm.
And then the large band in the center is painted. And then the yellow.
Okay.
Is it not?
Yeah. But what you can't see in this particular, on this screen anyway.
Projection. Yeah.
Yeah, is that on the far right is the yellow industrial paint. And then on the far left is, where's it going? Oh.
We're going into it.
Oh, okay. I was going to go on.
Where the edge is?
No.
On the left or?
No, no. Oh, no, no, no. On the other end of the painting.
We'll get there. We'll get there.
This is a flat. On the far left, that strip is, that piece and that piece of metal is a flat black industrial, like a Rust-Oleum flat black.
Now, we also can see on that strip in the center, which is raw, we can see the inconsistency of the steel.
Yeah.
The marks that are there. You didn't make those marks. They came there.
Yeah,
given to you free.
That's right, right. but the middle panel, which we're looking at now, is really a green. But here it appears black, but it's really a green.
Projection, yes.
And it's... That color was made by mixing the yellow on the right with the black on the left.
Okay.
And it makes a green.
Kind of a green residue of those two coming together.
Well, it's a green mixture.
Yeah.
Yeah. And but you, that's hard to see in this slide because it doesn't.
But they can get the idea.
Okay. All right.
I mean, actually seeing the work is better, and it happens right now. They are still being exhibited, are they not?
Yeah.
Until
the weekend.
This weekend?
Mm-hmm. Till, I think Sunday's the last. They're open Sunday.
Down in Soho on Green Street.
On Green Street, right, between Prince and Houston.
Okay, and then we have another work, which is kind of interesting because the work that we're seeing here is starting to become smaller,
mm-hmm.
and they're becoming more moved from this being rectangular, or in a vertical sense or in a horizontal sense.
Right.
So now we have all directions, in a way.
Yeah. Well, this
interior and exterior corners and
yes, that's right. That's right. Interior, yeah.
Which the others did not, so to speak, have.
No.
Here it plays very strong importance.
Yeah.
Interior corners. Okay, now it's a little difficult to see.
Mm-hmm.
You have to look very close. But which ones are the raw? Can you remember?
It's easier to say which are the painted because
okay.
I tried to find a square off of the edges, and in this case, the on the right hand side.
That square that's there with the.
There's a painted square. Yeah, it's black. It's flat black and
shiny
black.
It's rectangular in shape at a slightly diagonal. Is that one strip?
Yes.
Which forms a V with the other square over on the other side, on the left. Do you see that? It's not like a chalkboard that I can go up there and I can.
Yeah, I know.
It has a very geometric format to it.
I was trying to find a square by using the length of one of those edges, or actually two of the edges, and one is down, one is sort of a diagonal on the right, and the other's a diagonal on the left. And on the one on the left, it's where there's kind of a diagonal cut. It's not a straight cut. It's a diagonal at each of the ends, and then in the middle, I was looking for a square that came from that
place. Okay, then the painted areas is the square there.
The painted areas, yeah. In both cases, the painted areas.
In both cases, are painted.
Is the square.
And the rest are raw.
And the rest are raw.
Is
yeah.
raw. And where they
Wait
come together is
no.
almost
oh,
formulating
oh.
a V.
Actually, I made a mistake. There's the shiny black strip that is diagonal.
Yeah, on the
and,
right.
Yeah, and then the rest of that square
is
not raw. It's painted with Rust-Oleum
clear
spray.
Clear.
But I didn't. I sprayed it into a bottle and then brushed it on. Because I don't like to.
You don't the spray.
I don't like to spray, and I'm not good at it. So it makes a big puddle in one area, and then.
Oh, yeah. You're supposed to move.
Well, I know, but I always, you know, I don't do it well. So I squirt it into a bottle and then brush it on.
Okay.
So and that this
now,
one is called
this
Tumble.
This piece is called Trumble?
Tumble.
Tumble.
Yeah.
Tumble. And it's 34 by 38, so it's almost square. But it is small. It's smaller than life size, whereas a lot of your work before has been larger than life.
Yeah.
Either vertical or horizontal.
Right.
But here we're dealing with smaller than life size.
Right.
And so the thickness of it is, as you say, about a gauge 16.
Yeah.
So it sticks off from the wall just about not more than a quarter of an inch, right?
Yeah, well, it's the magnet's behind it, so that holds it up.
How thick is that?
The magnet is about a quarter of an inch, or
maybe
it's
a half
an inch.
Maybe it sticks off. Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, we have this piece, which is primarily vertical.
Yeah.
Again, we have a square.
Mm-hmm. I'm fine. The painted area is a square, and on the far right, the painted area, yeah, that
the
band
narrow
on, the,
one.
On the right is the clear spray brushed on, and on the far left, that piece is unpainted, I think. And this is called Shrug, and I thought it looked like a human movement.
A gesture.
Yeah, a human
movement.
Shrugging its shoulders.
Now this is vertically, it's almost 70 inches.
Yeah.
68.5.
Yeah.
And it's 32.5 inches or 33 inches wide.
Yeah.
And so we have the emphasis of a verticality, or it's almost like a figure, as you were saying.
Yeah.
Taking that gesture from the suggestion of the verticality,
right,
which is the
yeah.
figure form. Now then, there's one more that I would like to look at this point, and this is called April Afternoon.
Right.
And as we're making reference to the
yeah.
vegetation, the yellow vegetation, what does the black or the dark down at the bottom? What?
There are three strips, and the first one is a mixture of one of the yellows with the flat black, and it becomes a green.
Okay.
And the second one is.
As we're coming up from the very bottom in the
yeah.
in that dark area.
And. Oh, no. I'm coming down from the
You're coming down, okay.
The upper one. Is it green? And then there is the flat black, which was part of the mixture of the...
Okay, between them.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so the green is between the black and the yellows, all of the yellows. And the lower one is, as I often do, it's an unpainted piece of steel. And each of the top yellows is a different brand of... rust preventive paint, like, and they're all called something different. I use like Rust-Oleum and Exo Rust and Rust Tough, and there are lots of different brands, and they're different names. They have like School Bus Yellow and Safety Yellow and Sunrise, and you know, they all have different names like that, such as.
So, but the application is, if we could go into it and see some of the application of the surfaces. Again, it's not that you have a prescription of how it's going to be applied. It
no.
partly has to do with the way the thickness of the paint,
yeah,
and
the way it's
loaded in the brush, and the way it goes on as you pull it across.
Yeah.
And you can see that you have unprescribed processes of application.
Yeah. It probably a lot has to do with the width of the brush in each case. And as before, I would only use one brush for each kind of paint. And but I don't have that many brushes of the same. They're not all the same width brush.
Oh.
So some of them might be a thinner brush. Thinner in width,
yeah.
and in amount of bristles.
Okay, what I would like to do is look at some books that you have in the last, what, about 5-6 years, since 99, I think. And I think, which one's the earliest one? Is this
done by Art Press. Art Resources Transfer.
Is this the earliest one?
Yeah, this one here was one I
that
did.
You did in Wyoming.
Yeah. No, I did. Oh, some of it was done in Wyoming, and
yeah.
some of it was. I mean, they're different projects.
Yeah.
It's called Public. There are two books in one slipcase, and one is called Public, and one is called Private. And the one. That's called Private that you're looking at now was just a project that I did I have a, I grew up in Washington State, and I have a cottage in about three quarters of an acre there on a lake. And I did some paintings on the fence.
You have an open sheet in here, don't you?
Yeah. There are three open sheets. I did squares that were yellow paints and squares that were red and squares that were blue. And I mean strips that were red. And then there was a blue project. And
it looks like a paint company samples,
yeah,
in some ways.
Yeah, it does.
Here you can. Done on, yeah, the wall surface of.
Yeah. It was a cedar fence. And then I photographed it from 1982 to about 1982 to, or three, 1983.
A year's time, wasn't it?
Till 1990.
Okay.
And I made a book from that project. And then for this book, I went and took it again. After 1990, a lot of the squares and the stripes were still there. So I kept photographing them every year anyway. And when I went to this place, this residency in Wyoming, I organized all the slides and. In order to make this book of these of the years from 1983 to 2003.
Okay, now what we have right
here. So that's 20 years of paint on the fence.
Yeah, this is different brands of paint. Again.
Yes,
you like this playing with the different.
Paint or oil pastel or soft pastel,
yeah,
or and the paint was water.
How they stand up.
Yeah, there were only artists' paints, like there'd be artists' oil colors or watercolors or casein, and they'd be different brands of those kinds of paints. And the things that held up the longest with the red was the block oil paint and golden acrylic. Those were the two that held up.
Withstand.
Yeah. And actually, I think the golden acrylic is still there. It's in 2005.
Well, to me, that's a high quality.
Whoa. That's really amazing. In the yellow, it was very amazing because the two paints that ended up lasting, Markel oil pastel, you know, that's that fat oil pastel that they used to make, and it was bought out, the company was bought by Shiva. I know that because of this project. The Markel oil pastel and Liquitex acrylic paint lasted
pretty good.
I'm looking here, 2003. Let me get a better. Oh, no, this is a color chart that I also, let's see, let me get one where it's, I don't know if, can this be seen on the, this one here, this is in the water, and it's upside down, isn't it? Oh, the lake rises in the winter after the rainy season, and at the end, on the far right, that square is Liquitex paint, Liquitex acrylic paint, and then the next one to the left is Markel oil pastel, which really shocked me that held up so well. I mean, I thought that was quite amazing. So anyway, that's the thing that's called private, and it's called private because it's not a public piece. I mean, it's in my
it's
yard.
Your domain.
It's in my backyard, as it were. So in the public book, those are different projects that were in different public places, like the Islip Art Museum is one, and Long Island University, or CW Post College.
Yeah,
in
Long Island.
On Long Island. There's a piece, there's a weathering piece like that, the paint on the wall, maybe one of the first pages there. Yeah, that one, or is one.
Which is, yeah.
Those are different reds. Red, actually, by when I did the public pieces, they're only oil paint.
Looks like a Gestalt building, you know,
yeah.
with the geometric shapes.
Yeah, you know. Like a what?
Gestalt.
Yeah.
You know, Modrian.
Yeah. Oh, let me see. Is there one? Maybe there's one that shows. Oh, this is the whole. Is that possible to zero in? This is the whole thing, and this is the Gestalt building. I mean, yeah.
Well, it does look like it because of its geometry.
Yeah, I guess the light shines. Oh, yeah, and then the red paints. At this point, when for outdoors, in public, I only used oil paint and acrylic paint because I knew that because that holds up the longest. I mean, I didn't bother using watercolor and casein but casein does hold up too. But and then I let it run over into the parking lot. There's a little low wall in the parking lot, and so the yellow and the blue are in the parking lot.
But there is also
And there's a Brandeis University. The Rose Art Museum has a. I did some pieces on the stones outside of the Rose Art Museum.
You mean this one here?
No, that's an islip at the Islip Art Museum. And that's a shadows on the stones at the time of the.
Here's one which is shadows on the stones using the blue paint on the boulders.
Right.
So the element is.
Shadows as the time goes by during the day at the solstice.
Using a format of. At a certain time, and then you paint that shadow on there. Is that how it was done?
I paint the shadow as it appears. I just trace it and then fill it in. And then I write down what time it is. And at the time when the thing is filled, it says, it's underneath your thumb there, it's at. This is at noon. I painted this shadow as it was at noon. And
in other words, during the course of the day.
But at noon, this is when. But this is the this is the actual shadow filling up the painted shadow area. This is probably at 10 or maybe 9:30, 10, and then 11. Gradually, the real shadow fills up the painted shadow until. At noon, it completely fills it, and then it recesses. What does it do? Does it go, or does it go? I can't remember if it either withdraws or spills over. That's still noon, I guess. Later on, I think the shadow spills over it.
Okay, those are, and then you have this catalog that you just out. For the show that you're having right now.
The gallery, I didn't have much to do with that. The gallery did
The gallery
that.
Put this out.
Yeah.
Okay, but it's a catalog. If you go, you can see the catalog, but you can see the work.
That's, that should be, it should be better to see the work than the catalog. But,
you can see it at the same time, juxtapose them.
Yeah, you can make up your own mind.
Okay, if we could, we'd like to go back to the slides. Let's see, what we're looking at song. And this one again is 05. It's 52 inches by 48 inches. Again, it's more square.
Yeah.
And still life size, as opposed to being larger than life. Preventive, rust preventive.
Right. This is the slide that I thought that the second band from the top is a green. I mean, I thought it was green. It's a mixture of yellow, the top yellow, and
the black.
Then the black, which is the third band from the top, and that middle thing that looks brownish.
Or kind of muddy.
It looks like a muddy pond.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it's a combination of the yellow and the black mixed together.
And then down at the bottom, the one band down there,
that's unpainted.
That's not, doesn't have any clear.
Right.
Just
yeah.
plain.
Yeah.
Raw.
Just plain. Yeah.
Okay. Now here we have some stones.
Yeah.
Do you call them stones or rocks? Stones, probably.
Well, I guess I'd call them maybe stone. I don't know.
This one's stone. Called small A.
Small A, yeah. It's a small piece.
It's only eight by almost 7 inches, so
yeah.
It's almost square again.
Yeah.
And what you're sort of doing with the material in this case, the paint, what is connecting the what might be corners?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
And what has arrived at was, did you see the small A before, or
no.
Was it after you made the?
Afterwards. That's why I thought it. That's why it was.
That's how you come by
it,
whatever
yeah.
it is
yeah.
that happens.
Yeah. And on the actual stone itself, it doesn't look to me like the lower points of the A hit a corner, but I thought.
At that time, you did.
Yeah, I thought at the time. Maybe there's sometimes the stone has different levels. It dips down, and there's little pockets of material. And I think maybe there was a place where it dipped down and it made a corner.
Do you know what kind of stone this is?
It's a river stone. I don't know. It's a river stone.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. That's all right. Now we have another piece, which is called N.
N, yeah.
Is that north or what?
Well, there's an N in the.
Okay, you see it in the N.
And I like the way it curved on the top. And the
you
two
mean
points.
The kind of scallops that.
Yeah, the kind of scallops it made. And it's a very flat stone. It's flat, and but it's large. It's kind of large. And I decided to hang it so that the horizontal made a real horizontal on the wall.
I mean, the one line which goes across there
yeah.
is pretty horizontal. It's
yeah.
Actually, the piece is about 24 by 30 inches.
Yeah.
When you say large, for a stone, maybe it's large.
Well, to carry it in to the house,
okay,
it was
that's the measurement.
Yeah,
of it.
Right. It was heavy.
Now we have this piece, which is seemingly, this is made up of two stones,
right.
And so it's sort of put together sort of like your steel pieces,
yeah.
and that they're found. So
right, yeah.
They're found, you put two of them together, and then you connect the points,
yeah.
or what you feel at that time are points.
Right.
And this one becomes a large A.
Yeah.
What made the other one become a small A?
Well, it was smaller than this one.
You mean in size? Oh, only in size.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Because it was a capital.
Because it is a capital. Yeah.
They're both capitals,
right.
And I was trying to figure out
why it was a small A and
yeah.
it was really a large A.
Only with size.
Yeah, but compared to this A, it's
yeah.
smaller.
One's a baby and one's an adult.
Yeah. I like the way the top curved.
Yeah.
With the two stones.
Does that one the larger stone? Does that have a much more surface to it? Depth.
They both were pretty flat.
Okay, but it looks like I see shadow
yeah,
over them.
I think that maybe that did fall
just
back.
Dark.
Yeah, I have them on the wall now, in my studio. And I don't remember if they're the next one. I think the next one is more bulky and less flat. Yeah, this one, it doesn't appear to be here, but it's very sort of rounded, and so it's not so.
Well, this
flat.
One's 24 by 20 inches approximately,
it's
within a half inch.
Thick.
Oh, it's how thick?
very thick. I mean, it's
very heavy.
It's very heavy. Yes, probably about
like a brick.
Three
thickness
inches
of a brick. You know, a couple
in
inches
in places. But then it isn't. It isn't the same throughout.
It's like an arrowhead, which has different thicknesses.
Yeah, but it's big. It's bigger. Yeah. I mean, how big is that one?
You said it's 24 by 20 approximately.
Okay.
Within.
Yeah, I guess
half
that's not
inch.
So big, but. It was
not for the
heavy.
A.
Yeah. Not for what?
For the A.
Yeah, right.
The big A.
Yeah.
Okay, this one's called Z reversed.
Actually, it isn't really a Z, but.
That's all right.
It's all right.
That's what you thought it was,
yeah.
Wasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, that's your impression at the time.
Yeah.
For which derived the title.
Yeah.
Okay, we have. This is the one for which has a particular impetus for
all of the work, I guess.
In one way.
In one way, yeah.
And this is dated from 02, you say.
Yeah.
And the size of this is 12 inches by 12 inches. It's square.
Yeah. I did for Scythia paintings every year, but this was the one that I thought the slide would
show up better, show
yeah,
better.
Yeah, would show better, and it shows the different bands, you know, bands of color and
representative, more closely relating to the
paintings,
the steel paintings.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I can see the yellow having, but these are a little more orchestrated, the paint on it.
Here?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it appears by that, whether it is or not, I don't know.
What do you mean by orchestrated?
Well, I mean the way in which painting on canvas is obviously different than painting on metal.
Yeah.
And the way the amount of loading and all that, there's a whole different procedure.
Yeah, it's very different.
This is a baby. 12 inches by 12 inches.
Well, the small A was smaller than this.
Yeah, but I mean it's a small
little painting. Yeah.
I mean, when it's projected on this on a monitor and going out to any number of homes, nobody has any idea how big any of them could be.
That's
anything
true. Yeah, that's true.
Without a size relationship, either to a figure or to to a given size measurement, or a tape measure being right next to it.
Well, unless you have a person standing, I guess if you see a slide, you can't know what you're looking at at all.
So what we are going to be doing, and Merrill's going to have a show. It's going to be opening at the last part of October. It'll run for 6 weeks, and. Do you have any idea of what you might be thinking about at this time?
Well, maybe I'll show some of these that you just saw. Maybe I'll haul the stones out here.
Maybe you'll haul
the stones out here. Or maybe there'll be some new things.
Could be, could be. Maybe even some landscapes.
Yeah.
Because the objects, the references become kind of interesting during the hot summer, too.
Yeah,
the changes that go on.
Right.
And the transformations.
Yeah, I haven't painted in the last couple of weeks.
Ah, there's a good reason.
Yeah.
This is not maybe the best time to be out, but then you can be with the plants and that.
Yeah,
in the
early
same
morning it's not so bad, but, late at night, I mean, you know, before the sun goes down, it's pretty bad. But it's not supposed to hold up, this weather, is it? It's supposed to change.
I know, it's supposed to change here tomorrow, I think Wednesday. The transformation is supposed to set in. But then, you know, the weather person can be 50% right.
Yeah.
You know, there's no other job that has that option.
That's true.
So We have also one other catalog that...
That was made by Art Press, Art Resources Transfer. It was a bookstore in Chelsea, and they published books on artists, and the books are based on interviews just like we're having. And the owner is Bill Bartman, and
he does an introduction for each one that when he does them.
He does an introduction, but he did an interview. Well, there was an interview between him and Ann Messner, who's an artist friend and a friend. And so we had a three-way conversation. He does exhibitions of artists and conversations, and often there'll be two artists exhibiting at the same time in the same room, and then there'll be a conversation between the two of them that's transcribed, and that will be a basis for the work that's shown.
Now this catalog seems to be sort of a composite of your earlier private and public and some of your other work in here, besides an article by Lily.
Right. Yeah.
Lily Way.
Yeah. It's about all the different kinds of work that I've been doing, the work on stone and the work on steel and the landscape paintings and early work that I did with tape on plexiglass. And the outdoor projects. I forgot to say that there I did some other books. There's a book called Notes on Paint and a book called Time and Materials, which I can bring to the show.
Okay, that will be here when you have your show.
Yeah.
When were they done?
I think, let's see, Time and Materials was 1994, and Notes on Paint was around 1990.
Okay,
and I got an NEA for that. There's a book called Oil and Water in about 99. And then there was another book called Painted Sun Trails. It was an outdoor project at William Patterson College in Wayne, New Jersey.
Yeah.
So there are about five books. And I've been doing them about every 5 years.
So. Looks like you've been doing more than in just every 5 years, but
maybe.
More recently,
I think somebody else.
Been.
I didn't really work on this. In the way that I would work on the
public and private.
Things that were, for me, the books that I make myself, and I pay for them usually. I got a grant for one of them, but they are projects that are outdoors, and I photograph them over years, and they have to do with time and often with paint fading, and the only way you could see the project is to look at a book, because you see the passage of time from one page to the next, to the next, to the next. Otherwise, you wouldn't be able to experience the project if you didn't have a book.
Is there anything that we haven't...
There's a guy in the back says it's 10 minutes, 4 minutes, 1 minute.
Covered?
I don't know. I don't think so. I think we did a pretty good job.
we covered most of it.
Yeah.
Well, Merrill, I would like to thank you,
Merrill
Wagner,
who's
been with us this evening, and I would like to thank the audience for tuning in. And again, I'm James Carrol, and good night. New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530, or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA. Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.